Hey guys, this is David Kwan, here to talk about Metal Gear Solid 5 and how much I'm excited for this game. It was amazing to, it was really kind of bizarre, but still amazing that this was the game that was showcased in the Microsoft press conference. It was really weird too, because the press conference starts, and before they do anything, it starts with this trailer, which is a shortened trailer. The extended trailer is wow. But anyway, it starts with this trailer of Metal Gear Solid 5. It's like, whoa, what the heck? That just happened. And then afterwards, I forgot who it was. Was it Don Matrick or Phil Spencer? I think it was Don Matrick. Comes out, invites Kojima on the stage. Kojima says one sentence, butchers the English language, of course. But I mean, it's Kojima. We still love him. And goes out of the stage with that one sentence, talking about smart glass, like, what? Okay, really bizarre. This is not what I expected from, like, the first thing to happen on the Microsoft conference. It was a little weird, you know? It felt not as weird as Metal Gear Rising Revengeance happening, or Metal Gear Solid Rising announcement on Microsoft E3 conference, because that happened. That didn't feel as awkward because that thing is not considered like a canon official Metal Gear Solid game. But here comes Metal Gear Solid 5 on the Microsoft Xbox One. It's just weird to me because it makes me wonder, like, why did Kojima choose to highlight this game in a Microsoft conference instead of, I don't know, like, Sony's conference? And it's weird this year because Konami doesn't have their own conference. Or their, like, pre-E3 digital show or whatever. And, you know, Konami have done horrible jobs with their press conferences, but in the past, they have always ended up being the funniest, the most hilarious, the most entertaining press conference to watch, simply because they get really bad, and it's just really funny to watch Konami press conference. So, I don't know if I would say I'm disappointed that Konami didn't have one, but I don't know, I feel like they should have done one just to be fun. Because Konami conferences always get people talking just because they're goofy, they're fun, they're about the games, and, you know, Konami has a vision of they never do a good job of telling you, like, oh yeah, this is our vision of our future as a game company. They always do a horrible job, but it's always fun to watch them try to sell you on that. But anyway, it's weird, Metal Gear Solid 5 appearing on the Microsoft conference is something, to me, still, like, it just weirds me out. That trailer just felt so out of that picture of that whole conference. It's like, why does this trailer belong here? Doesn't make sense to me. Anyway, it's still going to be a great game to play on Xbox One, but it there's no selling point for that in regards to Xbox One. Is it a constantly connected world? Is there a cloud functioning behind it? Metal Gear Solid 5 and Xbox One is not like a perfect fit as like Titanfall or as like Forza or even Garden Warfare makes total sense to me why that's an Xbox One exclusive. But Metal Gear Solid 5 preferring to be shown on Microsoft conference over Sony's conference? I don't know. Just bizarre. Maybe Sony just didn't have time. I don't know. It's weird. Because it's just weird, just really weird. Anyway, moving on, Metal Gear Solid 5, totally exciting. I'm really excited with all the abilities that were shown. This looks like a much more serious, this looks to be the most serious, the most mature game that's ever been released for the franchise. Before Metal Gear Solid 5, that title went to Peace Walker. Peace Walker is definitely the most serious-minded Metal Gear Solid game ever released. That game has like one focus there. It's like, deterrence. That game has just one major focus. And I feel like Metal Gear Solid 5 is kind of expanding on that serious tone and really just going all out. This game is gonna have themes of racism, the element of child soldiers. It's going to be explored much more deeply than ever before, and the concept of revenge, of creating armies for the sake of, you know, fighting against total control by Cypher. This is the game to really bridge the link between Metal Gear, the original NES or MSX game, to Metal Gear Solid. You know, from Metal Gear 1 and 2 to Metal Gear Solid. This is the link between that. And I'm excited. Just the story. And what the hell is up with these graphics? Holy crap. How is this? Wow. Fox Engine looks fantastic. And seeing this open world happen, totally, I'm floored. And this, to me, if I had to pick game of show for E3, this is it for me. But I mean, I'm a total Metal Gear Solid fanboy. I love Metal Gear Solid. So, of course, this game is the game that, like, I'm just like, oh my god, Metal Gear Solid 5! I really have to wonder, like, how it's gonna look on the 360 or the PS3. Because I think that the footage that we've been shown so far of Metal Gear Solid 5 is running on a PC matched to the specs of Xbox One and matched to the specs of PS4. So we've already seen PC footage. And I like how Kojima's like, this is being developed on a PC, and we've shown you the PC footage, so it might be possible that we might release on a PC, but we're not sure, we're not ready to announce that yet. So that's pretty exciting that this game might actually come out on a PC platform not too long after the console releases. So that's pretty interesting, because all Metal Gear Solid games that were ever released, they released on consoles, and if they were ported over to PC, it happened way long. Like, Metal Gear Solid 1 was released to PC, or ported over to PC, 2 years after the PlayStation 1 release. 2 years, man, 2 years. Metal Gear Solid 2, it was a year after. Metal Gear Solid 3 was never ported to PC. Metal Gear Solid 4 was never ported to PC. So, the fact that Metal Gear Solid 5 could be ported to PC pretty immediately after the console releases is pretty an interesting thing. The fact that it's being released simultaneously on four different platforms is also a quite remarkable thing. How downscaled Fox Engine would be on Xbox 360 and PS3 is going to be interesting to see. I wonder how many discs the 360 version is going to be, if there's going to be multiple discs. I don't know, like, how much has the technology of engine compression and video and audio compression has become developed and up to the point where you can fit an open world Metal Gear Solid game into a 9GB DVD disc that 360 reads. That's an interesting question. But yeah, gameplay. Holy crap. Big Boss has so many new abilities. He can, he can still do the crouch walk that old Snake could do in MGS4. But he can do, like, you know, a crawling run. He can, like, sprint crawl. That's interesting. He can jump. This is big news, man. This is the first time Snake, in a playable Snake, could jump. He jumped across a building and on top of rooftops. Holy crap. That's huge. That's actually really huge for this franchise. I don't know if you guys realize that. That is huge. He could leap to cover. Oh, man. I have to wonder, like, how this dynamic CQC works. Oh my god, just gameplay alone, that's really exciting to me. And if you notice, in the trailer, Snake gets discovered, right? He does the CQC, takes a gun away from the enemy, and shoots the enemy. No exclamation points. The comical elements of Metal Gear Solid seems to have been destroyed, or they're no longer there. I don't know how I feel about that, because Metal Gear Solid, all Metal Gear Solid games, even Peace Walker with this serious deterrence focus, even Metal Gear Solid Peace Walker had really humorous, comical, fourth wall breaking elements that are the typical of Kojima's games. But it does seem like with the hiring of Troy Baker as the actor, voice actor for Ocelot, and Kiefer Sutherland as a voice actor for Big Boss, it does seem like this game is now moving away from the previous games in the franchise and just going in a totally serious route. I don't know how I feel about that. And on the one hand, I'm excited because it is a more mature take on this franchise, and it's going to take us into really dark places that Kojima had always, you know, I mean, the mind of Kojima taking us there. Ooh, man. So excited on one hand, but at the same time, I like the comical stuff of MGS4. It gets pretty ridiculous, you know, the no hairless monkey that's, you know, trying to depict the image of, the, trying to bring up the symbology of Adam and Eve. I mean, Metal Gear Solid has always been full of these crazy, goofy things. Metal Gear Solid Peace Walker, for example, there is a secret mission in which you can get in the same box as Kaz. You know, make of that what you will. What you will, you can get inside the love box with Kaz. There's so much comical stuff with every Metal Gear Solid game, and I'm not sure if I want to see all of that gone in the Metal Gear Solid game. And I do feel like a lot of that will be no longer existent in Metal Gear Solid 5. So, I'm kind of in a mixed jive, but it does feel like it's going to be quite an amazing game. I do have to wonder, like, the thing about open world, and stealth, the biggest problem is this. In an open world game where you're stealthy, if you're being stealthy, it's fine. It's an amazingly tense experience. What happens when you get discovered? Right? Metal Gear Solid games have always had this element of once you're discovered, there's a countdown timer that goes down and you have to solve the situation with the countdown timer going down. It's worked. I don't think that's going to work in open world games anymore. So with Metal Gear Solid 5 being open world, how does it handle once Big Boss or Snake is discovered after, or once he fails to be stealthy, what happens? Does that break the game? In a lot of stealth games, that actually breaks the game. Splinter Cell games. Really fun when you're trying to be stealthy. But when you fail to be stealthy, Splinter Cell games get really frustrating, really annoying. I hate playing Splinter Cell games after being discovered. I just pretty much say, this is what I do. When I play Splinter Cell games, not Conviction or the new one, the original Splinter Cell games from 1 to Chaos Theory. What I do is just like, oh my gosh, I've been discovered, I pause, I quit, I restart from my last save. That's exactly what I do with Splinter Cell games because failing stealth sucks in Splinter Cell games. Even Conviction, it's not fun. But Metal Gear Solid never had that problem. All Metal Gear Solid games, you're discovered, is still fun to play. And I have to wonder how Metal Gear Solid 5 is going to tackle this problem of failing to be discovered, like failing to be stealthy. Metal Gear Solid 4, I think, was the one game where it kind of was not the best way to do it, because it started turning into a third-person shooter in some cases. And it's not what I want Metal Gear Solid to be. So if Metal Gear Solid 5 is going that route, I'm not really too happy about that. But it's going to be interesting to see how stealth works in open world, and the story of Metal Gear Solid 5 with these amazing graphics that I've always adored, the facial expressions of Metal Gear Solid characters, whether they were PS2 or PS3. Because seriously, facial expressions that you see on Metal Gear Solid 4, on PS3 or 360, it's hard to think of games where it has that amount of fidelity in a person's face and their expressions. I think Metal Gear Solid games have always done just an incredible job with game characters' faces. And Metal Gear Solid 5 just takes that such a step further. I'm totally excited to be able to play this game. I'm a huge Metal Gear Solid fanboy, so totally excited for this.